Hey, for the longest time, people have been asking me, how do I go and build this old ESP8266 project of yours? And for the longest time, I didn't have the answer. It was just because I had kind of copied my own awful SDK over and over and over again. But now, for most of my ESP8266 projects, which are mostly built on ESP82xx, I have some really good answers. And so ESP82xx is kind of this extra, I don't want to say layer, it's not really a layer, it's just an extra kind of thing that fits alongside the non-OS SDK that can be built kind of on top of it, kind of underneath. But you don't really need a lot of its components, except one nice one is the toolchain that it has. And so it's built off of the pfalcon toolchain. And instead of having to actually go through all of these steps and pull down, I think it's like 6 gigabytes worth of stuff and compile it yourself, well, now I've already done all of that, and it works in a Windows subsystem for Linux. So what that means is you just go and install Windows subsystem for Linux, which is outside of the scope of this video, and then you're left with this terminal. Now, I've already installed it here, so a few of these steps are already kind of taken care of. So for one, you might want to like update. Two is you're going to want to install these packages, which, by the way, on the newest Ubuntu, they don't all exist, so you actually have to do this extra little step there. Not really going to bother with that at the moment. But what we're going to do is we're going to install the actual toolchain to /ESP8266. What that means is it's going to put it in your home folder, and it's not going to install it to the rest of your system, but that's just the default place for it to live. Most of the projects by default know to look there, so I recommend putting it there. And so I make the folder, I wget the file, and that's that right there. That's, what is it? It's 20 megabytes. And then you untar to the correct folder inside of ESP8266. So that's done. We've just installed an entire toolchain to work with a microcontroller. How cool is that? Next one. We're going to install the Espressif official non-OS SDK. And that's because some of the projects which use ESP8266 want the actual Espressif SDK, so I just did that. That's done. Next one that you're going to want to do is make sure that you're part of the dial-out group, and that's so that your user can just go flash the device directly in Windows or Linux or wherever. After you do that, you do need to unfortunately log out and back in. And we're back. Now that we're back, we've already added that, and there's a few other notes. For one, we're going to have to specify port because we're in Windows, and it's not going to be on /dev/gpyusb0. It's going to actually be somewhere else, so probably like USB 4 or something. And we can actually find that out really easily by clicking the Windows button and the pause button, boom, like that, to bring open the system, click on the device drivers, and then we can look under COM ports and see that, yes, in fact, it is right there, COM 4. And so we can unplug that, and we'll see that it goes away. And if we plug it back in, we'll see that it comes back. And now we're sure about that. Next thing that we're going to do is get a copy of channel 3, say. So, for instance, if we wanted to download channel 3, the broadcasting television on channel 3 from an ESP8266, we can say cd git, and then we can say git clone, and we can paste that right there, and we would have to say recurse-submodules. And the reason behind that is ESP8266 needs to pull down channel 3 needs to pull down ESP8266. And that's already done. So now I can say channel 3, and now I can say make all. And that's going to go clean out the library for the live GCC, make a really small one, and it's going to go build the entire project. And so that's what it's already done. So now we have the binaries that we're going to flash to our board here and here. So now that we have those binaries ready to rock and roll, we can say make burn. This won't work because it's looking for the port in the wrong place. But if we say port equals dev TTYS4, because that's what it is on this particular system, as we can already see right here, it should just flash to the device. Now this is going to flash, I think this one is a little bit slow. So on some systems, you can actually flash faster or slower. You may have to edit user.conf or CFG, and change potentially the baud rate that you're flashing at. That's just a thing you might need to do. But But we're already done. So now we should actually be running on this ESP8266 channel 3. So what I'm going to do is plug into the little RX pin there. It's a little bit difficult to see. It's actually even more difficult with whatever. Point is, find the thing that says RX, plug this little wire into it, and then now we have a little antenna, boom, that is connected to our little ESP here, and we can go take our television. Let's go look at the television. And we're going to go pop over to channel 3 and see if the thing appears there. It does not. Why does it not appear? Okay. Anyway, that is how you run at least this ESP82xx, in this case channel 3, on a little ESP core. And this one is the color version. Oh yeah, look at that color. Okay, I guess the other thing which I'd like to do in this video, now that we're doing quite well, is switching over to running Minecraft on our little ESP8266, or at least a Minecraft server. Okay, and so in order to run Minecraft, the version of Minecraft that you would need to interface to ESP8266 AVR craft, we're going to have to go to installations, we're going to have to say new installation, we're going to select from this menu 1.11, we'll just call it 1.11. We're going to say create, and I'm just going to make sure that this one actually fires up first, because the hardest thing in this that's going to be most unreliable is making Minecraft work. Though, at the same time, now that we're waiting, I can say git clone https github com/cnlore avr craft. And as always, recurse submodules. Boom, it's getting all of that, and it's getting ESP82xx. And so now if I say dumbcraft, or avrcraft cd ESP82xx, I can say make clean all, and then I can say, I guess at this point I would say just port equals, this is an example of where ESP82xx is out of date, so I'll get to show you guys how to update that. So if I say in cd into ESP82xx, I can say git checkout master, then I can say git pull, and what that'll do, or git pull master, git pull version master, git pull, git checkout master, maybe it was already there. Oh, okay, I just had to pull a new copy of ESP82xx. Sometimes ESP82xx on the given projects is out of date. In this case, it didn't work with Windows Subsystem for Linux, but now it does. And so now I can say port equals dev ttys4 make burn. This did not work because if I edit user.cfg, it was really only written to support Linux. And so the idea is that you would just change this number right here, but just by putting a question mark in front, it says, if and only if this hasn't already been written, we're going to override it. And so now this command should work. So it's installing the ESP8266. I'm going to click here, and I'm going to go connect to the ESP8266. Once it's connected, I can actually cmpeg my 216841, and it already is connected. And so now I'm pinging the ESP. If I decide to reset it like that, you'll see it disconnects and reconnects fairly quickly. So I can click on multiplayer, add server, Minecraft server 192.168.4.1, done. Let's go connect this bugger. Okay. And this looks like it's running the version of AVRCraft with the Enderman. So every time you flip one of these switches, the Enderman moves around. Now, just so you guys can see this, if you're curious about how you would change something, let's go do that right now. So let's take another peek at Dumbcraft here. Let's instead of it being an Enderman, let's make it somebody else. So spawn entity here. Let's go take a look at spawn entity and see. I need to use it's dumbutils.h. So spawn entity is going to be in here, and then EID. And so what we can do is we can Google Minecraft entity IDs and see what the Enderman is. Enderman. Is that 50? Oh, it's 58. Weird. Okay. That's right. So if we do spawn entity 58, yep, right there, it's Enderman. So if instead of being Enderman, we want to do, say, the Ender Dragon. Cool, let's go do that. 63. So boom, done, make, burn, and actually let's just say make all, make sure it rebuilds. It did not. So make clean, all, burn. I forgot to specify the port in either config or there, but I can just go back up and say that. So now it's reflashing, and as you can see, the ESP is disconnected, but soon Windows will automatically reconnect to the ESP. Once it's come back online, and this is going to go connect right there. Unless I have to eat my words, although I guess I did not select connect automatically. So, now that we're connected, I can connect to the Minecraft server, which it will eventually settle out and do. And boom, right there, Ender Dragon. And if we flip one of these switches, he will... Switch, he flies around somewhere random. Oh. Yeah, that's how you install AVR craft on the ESP8266. Yep, hope you guys liked it. Hopefully this video kind of explains how a lot of this stuff works. And yeah, let me know if you guys have fun with any of these projects.